Ladies and gentlemen, live from Queens, New York, it's Krista Brenner.
Thank you. Good afternoon, and thank you all for sticking it out this late from a long day of sessions, I should say. I'm Krista Brenner. I'm the Director of Open Government Programs at Reinvent Albany, and I am here today to talk and ask questions about what it means on a government website to be open. What are those basic principles? And so without cheating and looking at the handout, actually, I'd love to hear what you guys think open means. Does anybody have a guess? Any other examples? Let me work my way up. Otherwise, the live stream doesn't pick it up.
Well, just a basic thing is that it has a search engine function on it.
Excellent point. Ken Zalewski from Troy, New York.
I think an open government website should be interactive so to allow the public to participate.
Anyone else?
I think the information should be easy for people to find, or the tasks that they come to do should be easy to find how to do it, and that the language should be very easy to understand.
Anyone else?
One of the things that I found in a study I did a year ago on open government for our group was that too often government websites mirror the government structure, which the citizens don't know. And it needs to be understandable to citizens and not to the people who work for the government.
The structure, do you mean acronyms?
If you want a building permit, not everybody knows you want to go to the planning department to do that. You have to work there before you do. And those kinds of things are buried on a lot of sites where you want to do something that's for your life, which is get a building permit. You have to go all over the site to find out where you might get one and who you need to talk to.
All very excellent points. So Reinvent Albany spent some time looking over the internet to various sites such as the Sunlight Foundation, Civic Commons, OpenGov. And what we found was a lot of top 10 principles for open data, top 8 principles on open data, top 10 principles on open government, but nothing to get you started at the bare bones minimum, which would be your website. And so that's what this little handout that I also tweeted the link for anyone watching the live stream is about. And so it's just, what's the most basic thing that would get you to be open on a government agency website? So the first one is that government information is public information. And so the New York State Freedom of Information Law, or in government speak, FOIL, presumes that public access to government information, barring privacy, security, and intellectual property concerns. So obviously, if there's private information about an individual that would reveal their identity in some compromising way, we're not saying that should be public. But anything else, if there's a database with aggregate data, we're saying that information belongs to the public. So that's a very simple and basic principle, and if you approach the design of your website with that in mind, it will inform the way you present your information. And it was already brought up that information should be easy to find. You should not have to click through 10 different links or not be able to find a search function and just find yourself searching all over a website to find simple information. One thing that's become popular, and I'm not saying this is the basic is just that it should be easy to find. It's up to you how to go about doing that. But one example is people put the most popular links or the most popular links that are clicked on at the front of their website or in their FAQ, for example. But also search function, which someone mentioned earlier, is very important. So the URLs, which is the web address on the top, should also be very easy to find. So the third is that information should be easy to use and understand. So what does it mean to be easy to use? Does anyone have any thoughts on that? What's easy to use information? Translatable into another language. Now that's interesting. Any other thoughts? None? Well, we're also saying just that the document should be downloadable and should not just be unreadable PDFs, which tends to be a habit of a lot of agencies. And whether that's just because that was the standard way of doing things or perhaps because they have designers who put things into PDF. Regardless, we think that, and this is a basic principle across the web from thought leaders on this subject, that documents should be posted and downloadable in commonly used formats. So that's TXT, which is a text file, or CSV, or an Excel file, or a readable Word file that the machine can read and a person can download and copy and paste text, for example. And also, acronyms or esoteric language could be, like you were saying, government speak, like the planning office or something like that, where somebody wouldn't know what that really means if you're from outside that agency. It should be put in plain language. And also avoiding acronyms or, at the very least, having the acronyms have a link that explain what that acronym means. So the fourth is that information should be timely. Oh, I'm sorry, you had a question.
You talked about the PDFs again. Can we move towards PDFs, but that was
I'd like to talk about the PDFs again, because we moved to PDFs because we thought that was the generic and most accessible format. Telling people to post CSVs or Word documents implies that they have an application which is not freely available necessarily to display it. Also, it doesn't give you the opportunity to sort of embed complex stuff in an easily viewable format. If you have something that needs a chart or needs a picture or whatever, you can embed it in a PDF which is viewable with a free viewer, whereas post it as a Word document or as a complicated something that needs a complicated application, it may not be as accessible. So I guess I don't understand the aversion to PDFs.
Okay, we'll pass. Hold on, because the live stream doesn't pick it up unless you use the mic.
The issue with PDFs is that information is not very reusable, and it's not web searchable, typically. And the idea isn't to not have a PDF, which you might want to include one for version control, that for security, but is to also include other file formats. And if you say have a report that has a lot of formatting and tables and stuff in it and is complicated and looks cool and it might be in a graphic design program like say InDesign or something, which would lose its formatting in other things, great. PDF it, put that up, but also put up the text version, and take the tables or tabular or quantitative info that's in there and have that, which is pretty easy to do, in a CSV format. So it's readable, so that data is not lost. Because otherwise, what happens is that people cannot use the information and reuse it and analyze it. And it is very, very easy to post both the PDF and the other formats, which is the standard for open data sites. If you look Washington Octo, if anybody has their laptop open, has a data library, the usdata.gov, multiple formats. a file. And it's not real hard, and it doesn't take up a lot of memory.
You had a comment?
Yeah, and on the PDF itself, I ran into a problem just yesterday where I came across a government report. It was 254 pages long. Great, it had an index. It was PDF. I wanted to send 4 or 5 paragraphs to one of my colleagues. I copied it. I pasted it into my email program, and it came up all blocks. And I don't know if it was the particular version of Adobe or the way the PDF was, but I was not able to basically do a simple function like share. The only way I could share was download the whole document, send it to them, and say, go look at page 47.
Okay, thank you for that great example. Does that help?
So I think the issue with cutting and pasting is how it was distilled, and that's an error in distillation, in creation of PDF. But I understand the if you have huge data sets or something like that, there are some documents which it makes sense, or some data sets which it makes sense to post as sort of native processable data. But text documents, minutes from meetings or reports or what have you, I think PDFs are probably, the appropriate native format for people to access. So I guess I understand. Some places it's PDFs only, some places it's PDFs plus another native format. I get it.
Right, so I think the concept is that a PDF never originates as a PDF. It starts from somewhere. That text came from somewhere, or the numbers came from somewhere.
And the irony of the PDF format is that it's being used to make government data less usable for the general public, which is why on this one there's a very clear, strong consensus that if you want data to be open, or information open, that it has to also be in a non-PDF format. And so we use commonly usable format for that. It doesn't have to be proprietary. You can, something like, an open office or something, free download that you could look at. So CSV formats are readable with, any database or spreadsheet, et cetera.
Thanks.
One other thing we need to distinguish in terms of reusability, I mean, there's the one, on the one hand, you have people looking at this data, but I think the important thing about CSV format and whatnot is it's machine readable, and that's an important thing to folks. So it's not just about, an end user, pulling up a report and reading it, but it's also about, an application being able to consume that data and then repurpose it, or consume that data and other data, mash it up and create something entirely different.
All right, thank you. Yes, so yes, we were told years ago that PDF should be the universal format so everybody can access it, and it's now become a barrier to access. So the consensus, and it's not just us, we compiled this based on a consensus of experts in this issue area and people in government who are experiencing this, and then end users who are running into problems with PDFs and concerns. Imagine trying to read through a non-searchable 300-page PDF to look for information. And not everybody has that time. That wouldn't be considered accessible. But maybe it looks good, or maybe there's something else about it that requires a PDF. So, complement it with the PDF, but provide the information where it came from in raw form, text or CSV is the concept behind it. That's the general consensus. And that's actually probably, aside from government information being public information, I would say these easy-to-use documents are probably the most popular principle that's talked about around the world. So the last thing is just to welcome public feedback, and that could be in many ways, whether it's collaboration or good contact forms, or just ways for people to contact you and give you feedback. And for that to be planned, for a workflow to be in place behind that website where it's not going into a black hole, but something is actually done with that feedback. So those are the simple five principles. And below that, I just put 10 best practices. And it looks like my screen went blank. But I'll just read through them real quick in case anyone doesn't have it. Just that home pages should list the postal address and phone number and footer. How many of you have the postal address and phone number on your agency webpage? Does anyone not have that on their agency webpage?
We're recommending homepage.
On their homepage? Okay. The site should also include a comprehensive contact page, and I'll show you that in a second on the PowerPoint, which is the DEC is a great example of a really comprehensive contact form. Did you have a question, Jess?
That first thing about listing your postal address and phone number on the homepage, I might say that maybe an address what to mail someone something, or maybe not be the way that we're necessarily trying to have everyone communicate with us. I know that, you know, our agency and others are encouraging communication, but maybe through a means that's more real time or that could bring other people into the conversation. Do you know what I mean?
I understand what you're saying, but I had a feeling John would raise his hand on that.
If we get the PowerPoint up, we can look at a couple web pages the state uses. On the footer bar that is agencies use to have privacy policy and stuff like that, we recommend that the mailing address and the phone number both be there on the home page, because it is a very frequent complaint in good government and open government circles that people cannot figure out how to mail stuff to agencies. And just to make it easy, and unless someone's really looking for it down there, it's not going to be a problem, and you can put your contact link up a lot higher to steer traffic. So the idea isn't, we think everybody should call that, the switchboard at CIOFT rather than use your channel. It's just that it's actually a significant issue, in particular in city agencies, where a lot of agencies have actually scraped all of their mailing addresses off of their websites. And there's a strong consensus that government agencies are not businesses, and that much as the agency wants to control the public access, at the end of the day, the public has to be able to mail you, say, a legal notice or, whatever by U.S. Postal Mail, and be able to get a phone, a human on a phone. So anyway, that's the intent.
Postal physical, yeah. Right, excellent point. I guess the consensus from the good government is more mailing than physical, but to me as an end user, I certainly wonder where some agencies are located and if they're even in the place where they're serving.
Especially in local government.
Local government especially.
I think it's obviously more important to have both the physical and the mailing address.
So Dan's point is just that local, it becomes very important. So the other point is that not everybody has internet access all the time. So maybe they're accessing it at a library, but then need to get back in touch. And so just because they don't have broadband in their area, are we penalizing those people and not giving them access to their government? It's an open question. So there's a few other things, but I do want to get to the PowerPoint. So does anybody have any comments on the other best practices here? No comment? URL should be permanent. Well, that's one of my favorites. Back when I worked at the Senate, there was this system called LRS, which still exists and is still great. And there was an integration into the Senate website where you can search for bills, but then you couldn't email a link to someone or the bill because the link always said the same thing, and it would never actually link to the bill. So it's just to give you an example, or maybe that's not a clear enough example, but the link should be permanent so that if you email somebody a link, for example, they should be able to click on it and see the same page that you saw. That link, that URL, that address should always be the same and be displaying that same information, as opposed to it just being something visual that you see, but there's nothing on top that indicates the address of where that came from. So it could just be ny.gov, even though you're getting deeper and deeper into the website, there's no way to give someone that address or to save it and go back to it later. I think Dean also can probably explain that better than I can.
In that case, when you have like pages that are dynamically created, the URL isn't necessarily, you won't get that same URL each time that the page comes up. It's not like a static HTML page. So in the case of LRS, each time the page comes up, it's dynamically created, but there is no, you know, that URL, there is no set URL with the page. So what open legislation did different is it just associated a particular URL with a web page. Maybe it's something you've never even noticed before, but particularly if you go to a site where the pages are being created more dynamically.
There's a check on your open website list. What agency are you from? Digital Topaz. Okay, great. Yeah, and this applies to all levels of government. So I do want to get to the presentation so Dan has some time to speak about user design on open websites as well. So I'm going to skip to that, but I did tweet the script link so you can also find it there. So really quick, I just would like to show you here some of the things that we like on websites that we consider open. So here we have the Department of Environmental Conservation. It's one of our favorites these days. Well, the websites are constantly changing, so do tweet at us or email us and let us know other good agency websites. We'd love to see them. But here, and I'd like to give credit to Ben Yee for putting this PowerPoint together. You can see that there's multiple contact links, including a persistent link in the footer that is always there. So you can see at the bottom the contact us. So no matter where you are in the website, there is always that link in the footer to contact us. And there's it also lists the commissioner's name. You'd be surprised how many agencies do not list the name of the commissioner. And that's a very bare bones basic that people should know who's in charge of the agency. This one might be a little bit harder to see because there were so many things that we liked on this contact page. There's general contact info, there's specific contact info. There's even a contact widget, which is just, we think, is really cool. How to obtain documents, how to use FOIL, which goes back to the Freedom of Information Law. So people can find out if they can't find it on the website, but they think they have a right to that information as a citizen. How do you do that? And there's also service numbers, and the bonus is that it even lists the hours. So not every agency does that. So this is something we like and we think is a great example. Also, on the DEC website, you can see they provide some eGov services, or it's just some information about their services. And so you can go to permits and licenses and start breaking down, oh, I want to do hunting or fishing, and be able to dig in and go and find exactly what you're looking for in there. And you can see about all the different licenses and permits you can access from the DEC. The decals is the New York State's online licensing system. So there's four clicks to get to the online transaction there. I'm just going to keep moving through the PowerPoint. So also on the DEC page, you can always link back to the contact page, which we think is great. And you are not required to give your user information. You can remain anonymous if you choose to. And then there's also polls that we've seen on a bunch of agency sites. And some of them you can vote on a poll, but you can't see the results. So we just like to say, if you're going to do something like that, show the results, because it's quite frustrating for an end user to vote on something and then not see the results. Just a little tip. So this is Colorado's website, the state of Colorado website. And so we like this too, because it lists all the agencies. And because there's so many agencies, it could be overwhelming if each of them had a paragraph of information. I mean, you'd be scrolling forever. So they took advantage of technology that allows you to, when you click on it, expand the paragraph about a particular agency. And we just thought that was really cool and a really helpful way to organize everything in one place. There's also titles that link to the agency page. So you can click on that agency, see more information, and then decide you want to go there, and it'll bring you right there. And again, consistent navigation is really important so that users don't get lost inside your website. And so we found that the Colorado website has a consistent navigation, kind of like a sitemap, on the bottom with their help center, their alerts, and all their links, that you, no matter what page you're on, you will always see that. All right, so that's the end. I don't know if anybody has any comments about this before I pass the mic over to Dan, but I do have a few, actually, more points to say, which is, has anybody seen anything besides the DEC or the Colorado website that they think is really cool or really, really works? Any examples? Nobody? Nobody else has seen anything cool? Well, I hope after this that somebody emails us and says, you know what, our agency just made something really cool, and we're gonna show that to the world. Has anybody seen any other guidelines or guidance on what an open government website is? Maybe we missed something. This is certainly what we thought was the consensus, but we're not saying that it's the end all be all. This is a rough collection of thought. Did you see any sites? You see New York agencies that conflict with, they're not following these basic principles, you're saying? The state agencies are telling local governments that on their website they have to do something different?
Yes, that's right.
Could you tell us an example? Or?
Yeah, that one is a little tough for us. We're a group of about 140 towns and villages that all have a shared service for our websites and some other things, but we have our community cloud that we use. And we recently, with the budget bill that passed last year, there was also a regulation that says that we have to have a link, if we're an assessing unit, we have to have a link to the role in PDF format. Or at least that's their interpretation of the regulation. And it has to be at the top of our homepage. Having it in the navigation, consistent navigation, wasn't acceptable.
Okay.
So it's also position, not just what.
Wow, I didn't realize that legislation got that specific, that it tells you exactly where on your website a link should be. That's very interesting and very difficult to comply with, but I guess that it doesn't say that you should not put it in text or CSV form, CSV or text format as well. It's just saying the PDF needs to be in one specific place.
We have it in a searchable form.
You have it in a searchable form. And they wrote legislation because they didn't like your searchable form. Well, that is... very interesting. I would love to learn more after this. But I guess another open question, which perhaps we can't delve into in this session, is, you know, how far should the legislature go in legislating this? How far should an agency head go in creating policy that gets so specific that it tells you exactly where on your homepage something needs to be? Or when is it that we can just look at these simple, basic principles? And maybe it was just hard to find. Maybe people just don't know where to find these simple, basic principles, because the world out there on OpenGov and the discussions can be quite overwhelming. But perhaps another session next year could be, how far do we go in legislating or creating policy so specific that you can end up not being flexible enough to be open when that's your intent?
The legislation and creation of policy dictating to local governments what they have to do if they have a website is an extreme incentive for them not to have a website. That's one of the barriers, that as more and more legislation gets out as to what should be on a website, and if you are doing these processes, they must be on the website, creates another problem at the local level. Local level being town and village, as well as county, hyperlocal.
Well, thank you for that. I definitely think that there's further discussion to be had on this, and we will be following up on that. So follow us on Twitter or our website. Any other examples or guidelines that anyone has seen? Okay. So just to give a little bit more background, the general public has a lot of expectations about what agencies should put on their websites, and apparently that sometimes conflicts with legislation. But the feedback is probably filtering through people in this room. And so eventually, when people are demanding certain information for a website, that ends up going back to the IT department. So is anybody hearing anything else that perhaps we left out that the public is demanding that is filtering back to you? Are we pretty covered? Yes, John? Okay, so John's making the point that we didn't put anything about geodata or KML format, and so perhaps we'll have to revise our basics on here. Okay, so also, you are also the public. And we've all developed an expectation between our smartphones and access to the internet and Google and Facebook that we should be able to find things online. And from local government to state government, or state government to state government, agency to agency, we've developed this expectation that information should be available online and we shouldn't have to go through the process of mail or making a phone call. Not everybody, but the people who are working in IT obviously have. And so you are also the public. And so what do you expect of your agency? And what do you expect of other agencies that you have to interact with? Someone in the last session was talking about bringing together all the criminal justice agencies, and then they also are trying to coordinate with other agencies. And so we've built this expectation, and more public-facing technologies, the demand for public-facing technologies as opposed to back-end databases that may currently even still be on a mainframe somewhere, people are demanding more and more that database, those databases and other types of information be public-facing. And so the question for people here is, you know, what do we do with that demand? Are we prepared for it? Are we seeking to do something about it? Can we get out ahead of the curve by working with each other? It's another open question to think about. So the ultimate thing here is that a basic open government website is simplicity. Is key, which I know can be difficult if you're being legislated upon. But the public's expectations are realistic. they don't expect a super fancy website from a government agency. While they're nice and can be really cool, they're usually looking for something specific, a license, a permit, basic information. And so their expectations are realistic, and they expect you to put that information to the public base. So now I would like to introduce Dan from the New York State Senate, who is going to talk about the user interface on open government websites. Welcome, Dan.
You need to plug in? Nope, I don't actually need to plug in, because I don't actually have anything, just a couple notes.
Okay.
That perfect little segue there goes right into my first. That's because I probably don't talk loud enough. And I mumble. The first thing I really wanted to talk about was knowing your end user. Who is going to be using your public-facing website? Who is going to be using your private-facing website or your internal-facing website? And that is the question that I think is probably the most important part when you're looking at what should we be doing. As Chris was saying about permits, or you have to think, okay, first thing, someone's going to our website, and they're trying to find permits. And through that, you can use a couple different methods to finding it out. Number one is knowing what is being used on your website. And that's where analytics and that entire conceptual idea comes in handy. Sorry, I have to go for my notes. Has anyone have any experience with using analytics to determine how people use their websites? Has it been? Okay, yeah, that's where I was going to probably get to next. Analytics is a tracking unit that goes on your web page that tells you how many people have visited an individual web page, and you can use it to determine what people are clicking on your web page as well. You can design it so that people can, you can actually read, okay, so people are going to go look at the menu for permits and then go to phishing permits. You're able to figure out where they're actually looking at your web page and try to make it easier based on that. Train of thought, sorry. This is going to happen quite a few times, I apologize. So how do you end up developing for your end users? It is looking at what your users are trying to do on your web page. You have to come up with a list, a idea, a map of what you want someone to accomplish when you are going to redesign or build a web page. And that is where the concept of menus and how functional and how effective your menus are and your title bars and your sitemaps at the bottom of the page, how do those work, and how do people effectively get from place to place in your website? And then on top of that, how accessible is the most important parts of your site, and how do you effectively bring your site to the people, to what you want them to see? I mean, one of the big things is in web design right now is the big box of information with scrolling stuff that goes across. And one of the things that you can do is use big boxes, use bright colors, or things that fit inside your color scheme to bring out important parts of what you're trying to do. Because especially if you bring some colors in that aren't necessarily part of what you're normally doing, you always get your users' attention. If you see a bunch of greens and blues and like mountainous colors in the background, and then you have like a bright orange part of it for warnings and stuff like that, you're always going to bring people's attention to other parts and get them to focus on things. Like if there's... okay. Train of thought completely gone. I really apologize about that. Other thing is accessibility insofar as people with visual disabilities and motorized disabilities too. When you're building a website, are you able to think about what people can do if they are using screen readers or have low capability of using a mouse? There's a considerable amount of people out there, especially if you are at a government level, you should be concerned about how can people read and access our site regardless of their capability of using a standard computer, which kind of throws out Flash is kind of being very difficult to use in such situations. And so probably the last real point I wanted to get to was talking about workflows and end users and how we can find out what people want from our websites. Does anyone have any experience talking with their end users and trying to gather requirements from them on what they want? We'll just start over here. I'm going to skip you first.
Our situation is pretty unique because we're working with primarily small governments, but and so we are all the public and the web people. So we ask ourselves, but and we do a lot of that asking. And if you're in a small town or village, you don't have to ask either. People are very willing to tell you what they think. So it's certainly not as much an issue as it might be with the distance that these agencies are from the public.
Do you feel like you always know the right questions to ask, or people are telling you what? Are people giving you concrete ideas on what you can do better, or is it just kind of generally vague?
A little of each.
A little of each.
Yeah. Sometimes it's just a general complaint, and sometimes it's, why can't I find this?
The whole process becomes evolutionary. So you start with your, I'm going to say for lack of a better term, a focus group of users and individuals, and you get, you start with the questions, and then that question will evolve with the suggestions of the group. I think that's how we've run most of our all of our development within our project. By the way, that's been 7 years.
It's not the easiest to gather requirements from the general public if they're your end users. So often you end up getting it from the staff who deal with those end users for other reasons, whether it's casework or services, and sort of the feedback starts filtering through them, and then they need help passing that on because they're usually not people who can speak in technical terms. But that's definitely part of the requirements gathering process, and also inviting feedback and encouraging people to contact you.
I was just wondering if this isn't exactly kind of on the requirements gathering side, but kind of usability testing. So, you know, rather than asking folks, actually sitting them down in front of the application and watching exactly how they click through and are they kind of puzzled over such an, you know, a particular aspect, and just maybe if you could say a few words about that side of things.
Could you repeat that for me one more time?
Usability testing.
So where people
so rather than having them, you know, you're asking them what would you like, kind of that abstract requirements gathering, mm-hmm. rather you show them a prototype with the actual site, and then you watch them.
That's actually a fantastic way to go about doing it. One of the things that I've learned in my few years of doing web development is watching people do what they do. And to go back to what I was saying before about heat maps and analytics, you're able to actually watch what people do with them and figure out how are they going to do it and where do they get stuck and watch how much time they spend on a certain page trying to figure something out. And using it's much harder to use numbers than to use words to try to figure out where people are going wrong. But in the same token, you're also able to find what people aren't saying. You're able to look between the lines if you're looking in the right spot. With the specific example of what Dean said, there is, all right, same thing going on, sorry. You can watch people as a method of trying to figure out what people are doing, but you can also just look at the numbers as well. I think that's the one thing that people are not able to leverage well enough is using things like Google Analytics or Omniture or any other sort of site reporting vehicle in order to get the most out of what people are doing. And to that point, it also goes to what Chris was saying about commenting and the ability for people to actually give good feedback, even if it's like the most ridiculous thing ever. I used to work at a very, 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 very public-facing, large corporate site, and we got some of the most terrible, offensive, mean-spirited comments ever. And the one thing that we always did is we always got them, we always looked at them, and we always went through them and said, okay, where were they frustrated? What pages were they on when they were frustrated enough to contact us? And part of that helped us determine, okay, maybe they were really frustrated at a certain point, so that, because anytime the squeaky wheel will always get the most attention, and anytime anyone's going to come out of their way and contact you saying, this is really bad, you really just have to pay attention and try to pretend you're that person for some period of time, that it's got to be the way to make things happen. I don't really have much else. Anyone have anything else they want to talk about with user experience? I will go back.
We're almost at the end of the day, and I have to ask a hard open government question before the weekend. The state Senate site has lots of documents on it that has electronic forms for requiring through Freedom of Information request. And those documents would be really easy to post as downloadable files. They're all kinds of things. It's a nice page on the site. So why aren't they? And then second question is, web survey, why don't you guys publish your web survey or responses on your site, you know, like a SurveyMonkey graph per what Krista was saying? Like, do you find the site useful? You know, what's the thing you like the most? Little multiple choice, just so the user can see what other users are thinking.
I honestly don't have a response to that, but I'm going to open up to you, one of these four gentlemen here.
When you say that documents are posted on the site but not in an easily downloadable format, are you talking about like script embeds?
No, I'm talking about the page called the FOIL page, but it's the FOIL rules and regulations page. Mm-hmm. This is really common in the
So to repeat the question, there are some documents that are listed as accessible on the FOIL page of nysenate.gov, and why aren't we just linking to them, essentially? Download them. Well, some of those documents actually are available through OpenLedge. They're not quite as discoverable as we'd like them to be, perhaps. That's a good question.
Right. Once you have it through OpenLedge, or basically it's through OpenLedge, but then there's one about 14 categories that says what is form.
Yeah. And you know, I think that's a really good point. I mean, I think some of it, honestly. Okay. What was? I mean, basically, you kind of reiterated that it says FOIL form rather than the document. Because because on this there's links and they'll say FOIL form rather than open legislation. I think that's a good point, and it's good for, you know, the Senate to hear that folks actually want this information and this data. And frankly, I think some of it comes down to there's lots of NYSenate.gov has lots of different things going on with it, and you know we've got a queue of items. But to the extent that we hear these requests, we can kind of up things up in the queue. And then, you know, and frankly, there's some policy decisions and things like that that would have to be worked through. But I think it's good to the extent that we hear again and again that folks want this information, and that can kind of push it up the list of priorities.
Just on the same line of thinking, the first time anything is FOIable, it should be on your website. I mean, once you had to go through the work to make it available to someone, put it on your website already. Just post it.
That is
a good idea, certainly. But that requires a political mandate that I don't know that we have at the moment. So. I'm sorry? Well, because it also it requires resources. You need people. I mean, it seems trivial, but you do need people to upload the documents and post them.
Okay, so there's this discussion about foilable documents. So there are some databases that can be foiled 7,000 times in a year at certain state agencies. And I would like to know how it costs more resources for the agency to just put that searchable database online so that it doesn't have to be foiled than it would for a human being to sit behind that form. That human being is probably too low on the totem pole to actually make the final decision on where that goes, so they pass it on to someone else, who then does the search.
Who has to pass?
It to someone else? So anyway, you get my point, is how does that cost more resources than just putting the searchable database online? It's unclear to me. But the other point I just wanted to make while I still have the mic is that all these analytics are great and feedback forms are fantastic. But one thing that I see where the process breaks down and it doesn't get used is that it's not made to be anybody's job description. And so an organization will spend a ton of money on a really fancy analytics program, which they don't need, but looks cool. And people know it exists, but then it's not incorporated into someone's job description, and their supervisor is, hello. If it is in someone's job description, the supervisor doesn't understand that it takes time to process those analytics. So whether it's 1 hour on Mondays every week or 2 hours on Wednesdays every week or whatever it is, I often see the process breakdown and analytics and great information and feedback not getting processed because it does take time. It doesn't take a lot of time. Okay, I think that's it for this mic.
Probably the battery done. To answer John's question and to Mitch's point, and John's right, you can see the links on the website that say FOIL request for a particular piece of information, and the question, of course, is why isn't that information just linked there? That's a good point. I just wanted to bring it down to the local level, because in the city of Troy, where I'm an elected official, we have a FOIL officer. And technically speaking, we shouldn't need to have a FOIL officer because all of the information that's FOILable should be available. The problem is, again, you know, some, first of all, just there's folks in the city that just don't understand that you know, this information is public information and should be out there. And secondly, of course, small cities, towns, villages lack the resources to get all that information published. But I think there should be an effort statewide or, you know, countrywide that, you know, instead of a FOIL officer taking the time to make these, answer these FOIL requests, that we'd actually have an effort to get information published, and then you'll eventually go down to zero FOIL requests because everything that's FOILable will actually be on a city or municipality's website. So that, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, that is the ultimate goal. I'm trying to push our little city in that direction, but you can see that it's at the state level, city level, et cetera.
I just wanted to make one point about that, which is there may still be instances, probably only 5% of the time, but there may still be instances where you do need a FOIL officer because some information is questionable and would need to be analyzed by a lawyer, especially with HIPAA and FERPA and all these other privacy protections. So it's questionable, or sometimes information has to be redacted, so only part of the document would have to be given. So there may still be a need for a FOIL officer, but their work could be cut in half by putting the other stuff online, and that means it could speed up the process of getting back to the public with the redacted information or whatever the case may be.
Or you do away with a FOIL officer, and just as long as the requests are minimal now, because you're only dealing with very special cases, maybe the city's law department makes it part of their function, but it's not a full-time operation.
Well, it would be great to see analytics on that.
Does anyone have anything else at all? User experience, end users, use cases.
I don't have an agency site to refer to, but in looking at government sites all over the place, one thing that really bugs me is when they change the header on every page, because you never know you're still in the site. You get lost and don't know, is this still the official site, or have I been sent off somewhere? Yes. And they make them so fancy sometimes that you can't find the information you want.
This kind of goes down to like my design principles and my design philosophy when I'm working with websites. It's number one, keep it as simple as humanly possible. I cannot understate that enough. The Google method of keeping it simple is very, very effective at keeping people's attention and getting people to the right place at the right time. The other method, which I like to dub the Facebook method, is the one that overloads people, gives them a lot of information, and kind of throws it all over the place, and kind of doesn't always look the same in the same place at the same time. But it's both have their merits, but one of the things that I like to try to encourage, especially if you're off developing new sites, micro sites, or things as simple and as consistent as possible, use the same headers, use the same footers, and just change the information in between. Keeping things as consistent as possible will keep users engaged and keep them on the right path to doing well on your site. Yeah, find what they want and go run with it. I don't know. It's kind of got them out of its own. Yeah, and it's a...